Now, these are the words of Jesus, right? He himself said, it's to our benefit, it's to our advantage that he goes.
Hello, my friend. Jesus said, if we embrace the truth will release true freedom in our lives. I'm Dylan Waters. Come join me as we discover the truth.
Well, good day, family, and welcome here today with Discovering Truth with me, Pastor Dylan Waters. Well, it is my esteemed privilege to have with me today my district pastor. Now, just to give some background for you who Pastor Philip is before he introduces himself, both myself and Pastor Philip, we serve at the Bay Christian Family Church as pastors under the leadership of Pastor Allen and Pastor Janine Bagg. And so this man has greatly impacted my life. And for the next consecutive weeks, we're going to look at leadership, we're going to look at discipleship, but specifically today, we're going to look at discipleship. So it's my privilege to introduce to you today the man, as we know it at our church, as disciple-making machine. Pastor Philip, can you introduce yourself to the people?
Hallelujah. Look, I'm a firm believer in the fact that God uses ordinary people.
Yeah.
I've just learned that if that is my foundation, I can be a working vessel. In the hand of the master, but you know, I'm just a simple guy that started a home so many years ago, and I took the Bible and I made it practical. I've been applying it consistently for 9 years, and you know, within the Bay Christian Family Church, which I believe is a move of God, it has grown to, I think it's now about 97 home cells where we are now.
Wow.
So you know, discipleship works. It's just a case of whether you're willing to do what needs to be done.
I hear what you're saying.
And you know, I think, you know, there are so many different ways of how people see discipleship, but I found something that works for me. And for me personally, it's catching the heartbeat of the kingdom, and that's the desire to take interest in people. So some people see discipleship from the pulpit as where, you know, for me, that's what worked for me, with you asking me, you know, for me to introduce myself. It's catching it off the pulpit. What does it look like day-to-day, being in people's houses, being involved in the person life, and that's something we've tried to catch, me and Molly.
Now, if I were to ask you, how important would you say is discipleship when it comes to raising up leaders?
Sure, I think absolutely, you know, every church needs to have a foundation. And for me, discipleship is the mortar that keeps the bricks together. You know, I think a lot of people want to leave a legacy, and a lot of people want to build mega churches and do great things for God. But especially if we have a big church, your discipleship game should be, you know, intensely, intensely strong. Because, you know, for me personally, it's not so much about how anointed the speaker is. You know, that person can only draw as much as that. But the teaching is good. But when it comes down to sorting out the people's issues, that's a different ballgame.
Yeah.
You can't do that off the pulpit. Yeah. So then someone needs to go afterwards, after the impartation has been done, and then start cleaning up whatever the people then experiencing in their personal life with that teaching. So for me, you know, it's very high up there. You know, for me, it's probably the most important thing in the kingdom. But once again, I'm not short-sighted in saying that somebody else might experience prophesying is important to them in the kingdom, or teaching prosperity or deliverance or whatever. But I do think we need to remember this. Jesus didn't say go out and deliver people. He didn't say go out and heal people. Just hear me in context quickly. He first said go out and make disciples. Now, if you make disciples, it will be the foundation for holistic development. And that's what people need to catch.
So what you're saying is when we go out and we make disciples, then deliverance and healing is all part of that whole process.
Amen. That's going to be the core That's the word I'm looking for, well, where all those things will flow from.
Because you equip people within that area, right? When you sit with them. But if I were to bring somebody in here that has never heard the word discipleship, they don't know what it is, but they want to run for God. And I would say, Pastor Philip, please explain to this person what discipleship really is. And then after that, I give you the privilege to disciple that individual. How will that look?
All right, so I'm gonna take my time now to explain because I want the family to get what I'm saying. I always say to people, whether you're born again or not, you have a righteousness barometer. Okay, so what do I mean by that? A barometer is a device which if you would put heat underneath it, the liquid inside will spike up and you will see that there's a temperature that's more hot. So if somebody's not born again, their righteousness barometer is about 20% righteousness, 80% unrighteousness. That's just where they find themselves pertaining works. Now, bam, they become born again. Holy Spirit is inside of them. Now you can progressively start working with them. And so we're going to change the 30 to 70, 40 to 60, 50 to 50, and then move it over to now you're living in 60% righteousness. Mm. You still have a nature of 40% unrighteousness. So what I usually do is I then try to work with areas with where the person is undeveloped. And I won't necessarily call it discipleship. Or I would just work on those areas alongside of them, you know, through the power of the Holy Spirit, through me and through them, to eventually get victories in those areas. Then as soon as they start getting victories, whether it's a list of swearing or speaking bad to their spouse or them just having an area that's completely out of place, that's a poor character trait, then I will work on that. And that's what I believe discipleship is. It's taking the person's potential and making it a reality of what it's supposed to be. And I think that's the issue we have in the kingdom. You know, there's so many people out there that are born again. Great. Yeah. Okay. We can say Jesus is our Lord and Savior. But when it comes to having a skill or an ability to do what needs to be done, then we choke.
Sure.
And that's where we need to make sure that we're training up sons and daughters that have been well-skilled, been given the opportunity to grow into that legacy.
Now, I know, you know, when I met you, I wasn't spending time with people. I was traveling all over the place preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we saw thousands of people come to the Lord.
Yes.
You know, we saw the deliverances. But I was in and I was out.
Yeah.
You know, I was doing the work of the evangelist. I was going into a congregation. We were preaching for a weekend. We saw thousands saved. But then I realized something in my journey. That because once we go to a church, we build up relationship with that church. And then I go back the next year and I see the same people get saved the following year.
Sure.
And then the year after that, the same people get saved. And so there's one specific town, my own town, that I've went for 9 years, and I continually see the same people get saved, right? And then once I connected with you, I realized that they genuinely got saved at that crusade.
Yeah.
But nobody took responsibility of them after they got saved. Now, would you say that many people, and this is a very deep question, would you say that many people fall away, they backslide, because people are not taking responsibility of them, or what we would say discipleship, after they just give their life to Jesus?
Yeah, I see that, you know, I've been born again since 2007 now. You know, I've seen a lot of crusading happening in Cape Town specifically with mega events, and a lot of people are hyped to go to these mega events because it's big now and something's going to happen. So they become saved and then they kind of wait until the next big event comes, and that's like the pinnacle point and the highlight of the spiritual journey. What I've seen for specifically what we do at the Bain and with taking the nations, I think a lot of people put so much energy in just doing the main event that sometimes they feel like they don't have the energy to do anything else.
Mm.
But that's a little bit immature.
Naive.
So what I've seen with taking the nation is they spend so much time planning the main event, but their preparation and the work that needs to be done afterwards, they've put things in place for everybody to be followed up and then eventually be discipled. And I think as we grow as a mature church in the 21st century, we'll have to move away from just having a big event.
Mm.
Yes, we must do the big event. Mm. The glory of God is upon it. However, we need to partner in the kingdom in the fivefold.
Mm.
Because the evangelist isn't against the pastor.
Mm.
And the pastor isn't against the teacher. However, I've seen sometimes the one would make a comment about the other and then we're missing the point.
Sure.
The evangelist must get the people saved. But then they must have the necessary shepherds in partnership with that, in unity.
Mm.
Then he can come afterwards and shepherd God's people.
Sure. That is so profound. You know, Pastor Philip, one of the things I've seen now is that discipleship takes time.
For real.
It takes time and it is a sacrifice.
Amen.
Because I know in Paul, I said week in, week out, you're looking after all these areas with leaders and you're speaking to their finances, you're speaking to their marriage, you're speaking to their personal life, you're speaking to their job.
Mm-hmm.
But every single time when you have these meetings, it takes time. Now tell me the sacrifice when it comes to wanting to raise up leaders and wanting to disciple people in your personal life.
In my personal life, I've heard a quote once from let's call him evangelist Billy Graham. Some people just know him as Billy Graham. He said, discipleship will cost you everything.
Sure.
And for me personally, you know, if I say discipleship will cost you everything, then am I saying now, have I lost my car? Have I lost my wife? Have I lost my job? No, that's not what I'm saying. I've really had to lay my life down as a pastor and as a son of God to be really effective.
Mm.
And I can only disciple if I'm available.
Mm.
If I'm not available, that's purposeless.
Sure.
But it's a continuous balance between refreshing yourself, giving to people, refreshing yourself, giving you people. I always say intimacy with God will lead to busyness. But if you come too busy, you don't have intimacy with God anymore. Then you need to grow in the necessary consistency to step back into intimacy with God again and then get busy. And then step into the intimacy with God again and get busy. And it's a continuous flow between those two. But you know, if you wanted a one-liner, I would definitely say it would cost you everything.
Sure. Now, as I'm listening to you, the scripture comes up in my heart where Paul writes to Timothy and he says to Timothy, Timothy, the things I have taught you. Then he says this, find faithful men. Teach them what I've taught you so that they can teach other people. Now, as I look at the area that you pastor, and I'm part of that area with a group of other pastors, there's almost 1,000 people in that area. Now, I know, according to your own human capabilities, you'll never be able to pastor that 1,000 people.
Never.
So, discipleship has played a vital role where you duplicate yourself in people, that passion, that zeal, that commitment to the kingdom of God, but also the commitment to the vision of the house.
Yes.
So that when all these cells, how much, 90?
97
cells ran last night, right? You cannot be at all of them at the same time.
Hallelujah.
But this is the important thing here, and I get excited now because all of them are running, but they're running at the level of excellence. Why? Mm-hmm. Because you've spent time with those leaders. They've caught the heart of the ministry. They understand why we have home cells. But very importantly, they have a passion and a zeal for Jesus and for people. And all of this was produced through discipleship. Speak to me a little bit about that scripture and how important it is. Because when Paul writes to Timothy, he says very clearly, find faithful men. Doesn't just say, find anybody and teach them what I've taught you.
But see, that's the thing. And I think that's where a lot of people become despondent, Pastor Dylan. Is for you to run at that level, we need to find faithful men. You're going to have to have some fire in your loins.
Sure.
Because you're going to have to run after some people. Because after you found them, they might have the potential to be faithful, but they're not faithful yet.
Wow.
And I can honestly say to you, God didn't give me 99 righteous men when I started this journey. If most guys that are underneath my leadership, I had to pursue them. I had to build relationships with them. I had to put in more to get out more.
Mm.
And I think that's what people don't get from discipleship, is they see something that works, and then they think that everything is just like that. It's just Shazam.
Yeah.
That's not the case. So, you know, after you found individuals or people, now you need to start imparting and pumping them full of the apostles' doctrine, which is what Timothy speaks about with Apostle Paul. And then you need to work with everything that is the good, the bad, and the ugly to overcome and eventually get these guys to do and reboot what you got to do. But, you know, with some people, it's a work in progress. Because they have momentum, they are effective, but they never get to a point where they are the gold now.
Mm.
Gold meaning they've cleaned up the conduit so well on the outside. You know, some people are just great leaders, but they're still a work in progress. And, and we need to be mature enough to work with that. And they're still faithful.
Sure. Now, many times when we speak, I hear you speak about the Jethro style of leadership.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody knows the account. You know, Moses was counseling the people from dusk till dawn.
Yes.
And Jethro looked at this thing and said, he's going to become ineffective. Because there's 3 million people, he will not be able to counsel the people. So that Jethro then comes to Moses and says, Moses, you have to choose leaders of thousands, hundreds, fifties, and tens. And then let them look after the people.
Yeah.
And let them only bring the important matters to you. And then he says to him, there's a criteria by which you also have to select these men. He gives four criteria. He says, it has to be men that are competent. It has to be men that are God-fearing. It has to be men that are faithful. And then number four, he says that hate dishonest gain. Can we talk a little bit about that selection and that prerequisite when it comes to stepping into leadership and how discipleship is vital in developing these qualities within these people?
Okay, so, you know, the Jethro leadership system, let me start there, works definitely. But I think the makeup of what it should look like should be authentic. Otherwise, it's going to be a broken system.
You.
Because if you don't follow that criteria, which you just said now, those four foundations, then you might be an executive leader at the top that needs to run around a lot to lower levels of leadership because the foundation wasn't built right.
Mm.
See, every level of leadership only really works. You know, we know what the titles are within our church. But let's say you have a leadership structure of about 1 to 8 levels. Every level is only as solid as those leaders are emotionally intelligent and if they have intimacy with each other on that level, meaning they have good, strong relationship with the people on the side and they at least have good, solid relationship with the person above them and beneath them. That keeps the link going. But the most important thing with what you're saying with those four key pillars, you know, every leadership structure or leadership calling has an expectation of certain things that need to be in place for that person to fulfill their role. But what we need to understand is many people step into this role because they're willing. And over years of consistency and endurance, they grow to a high level. Then many times people only get to those four attributes if they have proven themselves faithful over a 3, 5 year, 7 year, 10 year period. But we need to be willing to work with people to grow them consistently over a period of time to step into those four. Now, and I think that's where people lose hope because you might, you know, spend a lot of energy on 5 or 6 leaders and they just run out on you. Then you need to have the necessary capacity and urgency to reboot that. Because many times I would ask myself if I would be stripped of my leadership calling now, can I redo what I've done and can I do it in half the years I've done it before? Because, you know, then I've actually learned and gained some experience on what I've actually been doing in the last 9 years within this specific church. But I think we should never have these pillars as a rod or a stick to bruise people for them to just be better. For some people, it's unfortunately a process. And no matter how the bar we set for some people, it's a model to which you need to work towards. And if we're going to disqualify everybody because they don't fit the mold, we're not going to get anywhere.
Exactly. Wow. Now, you mentioned something so profound there. You said that many a times you embark on this journey called discipleship with somebody and you invest and you invest and then that person cops out. Now, I want to ask you this question because somebody is looking and saying, this sounds like a lot of work. And I know you always say ministry is spelled W-O-R-K, work. Now, I know you personally at the moment, you have around about 190 leaders under you, more or less.
Yeah.
And then with that 190 leaders, you look after around about 1,000 people, more or less.
Yeah, it's more than that, but let's go with
the 1,000 people. Yeah. Now, within this 9 years of building from one cell to 97 cells to 180 leaders to 1,000 active people within an area, obviously, you've been hurt. You've invested many a times in people's lives. Now, this is a deep question now. And you've invested your time. I know you and your wife. You're generous people. You've opened your house for people. People sometimes come stay there. You disciple until 11 o'clock at night. you have made the sacrifice that you've just spoke about. But now, after you've done all of this and you've invested in people and you've spent time on them and get them married, get them discipled, get them work, get them through university, you've been there, and they just cop out. They just leave. How do you handle this? How do you deal with this? Because somebody's sitting there and saying, maybe you've done it. Maybe you've walked with people. You've invested in people and they've walked out on you. And maybe you're still sitting there because you've earmarked that young man or woman to take over the ministry one day. And now they're not there. How do you deal with this hurt?
Yeah, the thing is, you know, in the beginning, I've really taken a very personal posture that I kind of felt like people were walking out on me. And then over the years, I've learned that this is between them and Jesus. Many are called, but few are chosen. So what I've learned with that is every single year, they choose a new Springbok team.
Sure.
You need to prove faithful every year.
Yeah.
You need to do the hard yards, do the off-season training. And I do that. And I can be honest with you, you know, when it gets to the end of the year, there's a piece of my heart that's pretty banged up because I've lost some disciples. But I've always, you know, said to myself that, you know, I need to keep myself accountable to my call.
Mm.
And then if I set that example, those that desire to do the same, that also want to be loyal, that also want to be faithful, will follow that. I've just rolled the care, as they say, in trying to figure out why people are doing what they're doing, because it's not healthy for me.
Mm.
And the point I want to make is this. I took it so personal in the beginning that I was wearing my emotions on my sleeves too much.
Sure.
So now when, you know, these things happen, I take care of the well-being of my heart.
Mm.
Why? Because if I don't take care of the well-being of my heart, I can't serve God's people that are actually still with me to the best of my ability.
Sure.
Now I'm in my immaturity still going out about the person that copped out about me, but the old people that are still with me, that wants to spend time with me. And I've learned to you learn to deal with certain things better. And I think you should really seek for opportunity to bless those people.
Sure.
If you ever see them in the future again, actually now I'm currently busy with a leader who hurt me a few years ago, and then I saw the opportunity to bring them back on board.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's the love of God.
Wow. Sure.
You know, I could have been stuck in that mindset and said, it's okay. I know what you did 2-3 years ago. You're not coming back. There's no chance.
Sure.
However, if you really sit and think about it for a long while, if God is going to restore something, is it going to be over and above my personal thoughts and opinions?
Wow. Sure.
And if he wants to bring somebody back on board, who am I to do that? Because they might lead a lot stronger from the previous season.
Oh, this is so good. This is so good. We can stop now. We can stop this whole thing now, because many people have been hurt in ministry. Yeah. You and I both have been hurt.
Yeah.
And what you said now is so profound, that when you on the side where the hurt happened, where you got hurt, and that person that hurt you left, but they want to come back now and run for the Lord again, you cannot hold that hurt against them.
I cannot. Because just imagine that, Pastor. Then imagine Jesus is walking to the cross and he throws the cross down and he says, "You're unchanging, I'm not going to the cross anymore." And then he picks it up again and he walks for a while, and then he throws his cross down again and he says, "You're not working with me. You're hurting me too much. I'm not going to the cross for you anymore." And that's where we need to understand that, yes, Jesus paid the price. He's paid the full price. He knows. He knows exactly what all these pastors are going through, all these leaders that are running churches and running ministry, because when has it become worth it? When on a Wednesday night, I can now all of a sudden see that we have 50 newcomers at Home Soul every week. It's way more than that. But, you know, across 94 Home Souls, there's nearly at least 90 newcomers. Some of these people getting to know the gospel for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And that's authentic. And you can't take that away from them, because God can even take a dysfunctional leader and the person can have a God encounter on the other side, because the word of God is the word of God. The inability of a leader cannot steal the power of the word of God. That's what we need to learn.
Sure. Now, Pastor Philip, how do you keep your heart pure? How do you, and we're speaking to people and to leaders now, how do you, after being hurt, after things have been said, after you've been backstabbed, after you've been betrayed, after people have walked out of you that has vowed to stay with you, how do you keep your heart pure and solid?
Yeah, so first and foremost, I think it's so important to be in Christ. So for me, Philip in Christ is crucial. I'm not pastor in Christ. I'm Philip in Christ. Mm. So I need to really know that God loves me. I usually read Ephesians 1 that speaks about we are chosen, we are redeemed. And, it comes down to your identity, Pastor Dylan. You need to have a strong identity in Christ, irrespective of what people say about you. Because many times when I have situations like this, you know, it reflects bad on my leadership. I can't now go into a state of I'm not good enough. So first and foremost, my identity, which is my relationship with God.
Mm.
And then secondly, I really take the time to debrief myself and say to myself, how could I have done this better? What can I learn from this to never get in a situation like this? But we also then thirdly need to understand this is life.
Mm.
You know, we're supposed to be people that can lead through setbacks.
Mm.
We're supposed to be people that can lead through the fire.
Mm.
If you want to slay giants, then you can't do that, then you're in the wrong game.
Mm.
Because we all want to do great business for God. We want to do great things for God. But we can't handle the weight and the burden goes with that. Then you should rather stand on the sideline and carry the water and allow the quarterbacks to do what they got to do.
Sure.
Because there's a certain level of burden that comes with leading people. And that's the one key thing I cannot say to you how you can get rid of.
Sure.
Because cleaning up my heart is my part. But the burden that comes with it, we should use it as an earmark or a conscious awareness that we have a responsibility to do this.
Sure.
And but you know, with your question, the most important thing for me is you have to spend time in the presence of God. You know, I fast every year at least once, and I see it as a restorative season where God continues to speak to me and He confirms things He said to me before, and that's vitally important.
Sure. Now there's a sweet anointing here. I know there's maybe somebody watching here and you maybe walked out on a ministry because of something that happened. You got hurt. Maybe you're sitting on the other side where you are the leader and a protege that you've invested in hurt you. And I really just want you to take this opportunity, Pastor Philip, to speak to both. Speak to the church person that took offense, that got hurt, that felt they betrayed, and they left the ministry that God has called them to. But also then speak to the leader that got hurt because that individual left. Amen. Just look into the camera and speak, please.
All right. So the first thing I want to say is, you know, I've seen many times that people walk strong with their pastors. And you might be a leader today that you've walked strong with your pastors, but somewhere there was an offense, somewhere there was a disconnect, and the enemy has completely perverted your perspective of this person. But God can completely restore the way you see these people. And I want to call you back. I want to call you back to ask God, pray about it, spend time in His Word. Go back to the Scriptures which God has given you. Because God has clearly spoken to me in Isaiah 52 verse 12 when I had to plug into the local church where we serve.
Yeah.
But I want to encourage you to go back to that. And when you do that and you spend time in the presence of God, God will then give you a refreshed and a renewed perspective of your pastors. Because there's an anointing on that relationship. But you will only find that refreshing as you step back into the presence of God. Then I also want to just speak to pastors that are hurt through people that have been with Him in ministry. You need to remember that you can only serve God to the best of your ability and to His people if you take care of the well-being of your heart, which is the fountain of life. And you need to remember that holding grudges and feeling rejected and having unforgiveness doesn't make you an excellent pastor. It makes you worn down. It makes you busted and disgusted. You need to remember that we need to lead excellently. And if we need to lead excellently, we need to get rid of those things.
Yeah.
Because it's God's heart's desire for us to be whole.
Sure.
And I want to encourage you pastors, that if there are people that have walked out on you, make right with them. Forgive them. If you don't feel that you are strengthened to speak to them, find avenues and ways to bless them.
Yeah.
And that will minister the love of God to them. All right. Hallelujah.
Amen. I know you received that. Now, Pastor Philip, we have said many a times, and I know you've said with many leaders and people take offense.
That's a real thing, eh?
People take offense. And when you say that, offense is never given, it's always taken.
Yeah.
And, you know, we confess, praise Jesus, we're unoffendable. Sometimes something comes along, but the biggity feathers are up.
No, for real.
And what would you say in your life when it comes to this? Because I've known in our relationship, you've said with me, you've also been hurt, you've also taken offense sometimes. How do you get rid of that?
Yeah, look, obviously, I think we need to understand the tactic of the enemy. You know, obviously, if I would go into teaching, I might get my paraphrasing and scriptures and whatever wrong, because it's not something I've looked into recently. But at a certain stage, I looked at the word offense. And in studying it, when you look at it in the Greek and Hebrew, there's one meaning you find, which is called, it's to set a snare, to set a trap.
Wow.
So look, we all were young. We all were we did some interesting things. And what I used to do is when I was a kid, I used to have a box which I would put on my lawn, and I would put breadcrumbs in the box. And then I would have this little stick which the box lies in. And it just makes it high enough for a little bird to come underneath and eat the food. And then I obviously have a long string to the sliding door. And when he's inside the box, I would pull the wire and the box will fall on him. Now, if you set a snare for somebody, you need to remember that they have no awareness of the fact that it's going to happen.
Wow.
So now this bird comes. He comes for the food. We, the born-again believers, we go for the word every weekend. But there's this offense going to come above our heads. Sure. Now, you're minding your own business in the kingdom. You just want to listen to the word. Now, what does Pastor Alan always teach us? The enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. What does he want to kill, steal, and destroy? First and foremost, the word. So now, while you're eating the word on the Sunday, shazam, immediately something happens. Now, if you're focusing on the word, do you see the trap that's set for you above here? Not at all.
Sure.
You need to understand what this has been designed to do. It has been designed to rip everything out of context. And we need to understand how offense works. And then if things happen to you, then it will give you the necessary maturity to lead through these things. Because then you will learn that it's not personal. And you know, certain things is just you can't explain it. Certain things is just like, but this person should have been better. Come on, man, I'm offended now.
Yeah.
But rightfully so, God has ministered to me and he said to me, look, son, are you here to be offended or are you here to be effective? I choose effective way over and above being offended. Because other people's mediocrity cannot allow me to become a lesser version of myself. And that's what we need to remember.
Sure.
So for me personally, in my identity, I'm very secure with understanding that offense has been designed as a strategy from the enemy. Strategy is a strong word because he's thought about how he wants to take you out. And that's what we need to learn, that when offenses come, offenses are hurt, that we govern and lead ourselves out of that emotional realm immediately into our secure spirit, man, because we want the best version we possibly want to be as a son or a daughter in the kingdom.
Sure. That is so profound, because I'm listening to what you're saying and I'm asking myself the question then, how does somebody that has really been deeply hurt, but they don't want to talk about the hurt, you know, they just stay away. They take the offense, they stay away, and you as a leader now, doesn't matter if you've been hurt, you got to reach out continually. Because you've mentioned previously that the love of Jesus is what drives us.
Yes.
And so as a leader, it's almost impossible for you to harbor that offense because of the people you're looking after.
Yeah.
You can't shepherd the people accurately with an offended heart.
No, you can't. Not at all. You know, I believe there's a grace period for God to give you. I can't say how long the grace period is. But God knows your heart. You know, we all know what David did and God was still with him. But there's a grace period for you to sort things out. So God's grace will cover it. You know, because he knows your heart that you're going to man up and deal with it. We're all human in the sense that we're going to have to take some time to just work through the emotions and whatever. Some people it's 3 months, other people it's 6 months. But I can't make a bold and stupid statement and say 20 years.
Sure.
Because, you know, you'll have a harvest if you're harboring that in 20 years. But I think that is vitally important with our approach as shepherds is, how can we be casting out devils of unforgiveness?
Sure.
If we're struggling with it ourselves.
Yeah, sure.
Now, what is the strategy of the enemy? He's going to use people that walk out on you to get that unforgiveness back into your life. And you will just need to, you know, in your journey of working with people, learn to understand that God is giving you stronger armor here, spiritually.
Sure.
That these fiery darts of the enemy, they just don't sit on you anymore.
Yeah.
They just, you know, they're just flying around here.
Yeah.
Because you've grown in the kingdom.
Sure.
And because, you know, these things happen, they can either break you or they can make you. And we as pastors should allow these hurts to become a deepened work of the Lord in our lives. To lead stronger, to be more effective, to be more on fire. Because every setback is an opportunity for you to lead poorer.
Sure.
And we should just see it as stepping stones to go higher.
Yeah.
Hallelujah, yes.
Wow. Now, Pastor Philip, 9 years ago, you started the cell there in Stellenbosch, right?
That was in the northern suburbs.
In the northern suburbs, yeah. 9 years ago. And within that area, when you started that first home cell, you planted out with your wife, Pastor Marley. So of that people that was there, how many people are still left today?
Praise the Lord. Look, you know, every person that was in that home cell was beautiful. Each of them were is loved by God. But I believe God has graciously given us people that want to run with us.
Yeah.
But there was 22 people at the multiplication after about 6 months. And today we're five left. And of those five, it's me and my wife. It's two pastors. Well, four are pastors now. Mm. And the other one is soon to be. So it was a good harvest. But that's the key decision we've made over the years is we want to run to raise up disciple-making machines.
Yeah.
And that's the key thing we need to remember. It's not everybody will stay with us. We need to be looking for those that are called to stay
exactly.
with us.
Exactly. That is important.
That's where we will find joy in ministry.
Sure. That is very important. That leads me to my other question, is that you started with 22 people, now there's five left. And it's a liberating thought that not everybody that comes will stay. I know we want everybody to stay. If everybody ever stayed that visited the homes, how many people would we be today? 6,000, 7,000, 8,000 people.
Pastor Dylan, we will have a mega, mega church.
It would have been mega, mega.
That's heavy.
But not everybody stays. And you got to, as a pastor, you have to learn that sometimes people leave.
No, for real. You know, just on just to comment on that, in 9 years, I can without a doubt say, there's easily probably been about 50,000 people through our cells.
Sure.
I can honestly say that. I've watched the stats for 9 years now.
Wow.
And, you know, we've really evangelized a lot. But, you know, when you catch fish, you don't always keep all the fish. You look for the selected few you want.
Yeah.
Sorry, just paraphrase your question quickly.
My question was just, how do you deal with that? Because I know, you know, me as a shepherd, when somebody leaves, you hurt. You know, you want everybody to stay. You have this expectation for everybody to stay. But people don't
Got
stay.
You. So I think what is most important is for me in 9 years, I've only looked primarily for disciples. Mm. I've looked for people that want to lead. Mm. Because if I'm finding those gifts, then eventually, very easily, I'll have 10 to 15 people that will be drawn to the gifting. And I think that's the thing that's kept me sane in this journey. Is I'm not trying to get numbers, I'm trying to be effective.
Mm.
If I'm trying to be effective, it will lead to numbers.
Sure.
And we read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. There's enough numbers there for us to stand that God doesn't have a problem with speaking about numbers.
Yeah.
But I think that's the key thing is, for me personally, I can honestly say this, in 9 years, the only thing we've kept in home cells, in our leadership, or in our churches is 190 leaders.
Wow.
There's a few people I can show you that might still be in home cell that's been there for 9 years that hasn't been utilized. Because what do you think is going to happen? If you, for instance, serve in a Christian fellowship and you're there for the first season and you see the one person steps up, then you go to the second season, you see the next person steps up, then you go to the third season of being in this Christian fellowship, well, here's another person stepping up. Mustn't I start doing something?
Sure.
Then either what happens is the person decides they're just going to find another grazing field where they're comfortable. Or they're going to say, like, maybe I should do what they're doing. Let's do the step up.
Sure.
It's a normal procedure that will happen through the seasons of these fellowships.
Sure. You know, when I listen to you, I hear that there's no complacency in discipleship.
Mm-mm.
There's no complacency. Now, I know you personally. You run. You know, one night I was at church and I couldn't get the safe open. And I called you and I said, I cannot get the safe open, man. And your response to me was, okay, I'm on my way. But this was like 9 o'clock, you know. And I'm thinking, no, just tell me. I'm just telling you as an accountable that I cannot get the safe open to get to you what I need to get to you. And your response to me was, let me come and sort it out. Now, I know when I looked at this whole period of when COVID-19 started.
Yeah.
The home cells have been multiplying.
Praise God, man.
You know, the area has been growing.
Hallelujah.
I know you're a man of numbers. So how many home cells since lockdown started have we multiplied?
Well, this year alone, we've added in the five areas 26 new home cells.
Wow.
So we've probably done about 35, 40.
40 home sales.
Yeah, from last year to now.
And so I'm right when I'm saying that, you know, even though lockdown came and the church was closed for a few months and then it's open again, it's closed again, and then we can only meet, you know, 50 people, and then we meet on Zoom, and then we meet on WhatsApp. How, I want you to speak to pastors now, how did you keep this vision alive? How did you continually see growth? Growth in all these areas, because I know 40 home sales since we had COVID up until now, you know, we've been pumping it. We've been seeing the growth. Speak to pastors, please.
All right, so a key thing which I very, very easily noted when we went into COVID, I think I went into this 6 week, was a full 6 week journey, and I see the way my leaders reacted after 6 weeks, and I thought to myself, we're in trouble here. We're gonna have to lead these people out of this season. So what we did is what we usually didn't do is we didn't have a meeting every week. We would have occasional meetings. And then I made a quality decision that with my top leadership structure, we will have a meeting every single week. And after I've installed that, the only thing we could keep accountable was our leadership, because those are the people we first and foremost had strong relationships with. And I want to encourage pastors to do that. Is if you keep your leadership on fire, they will have the necessary fire and urgency to reboot and rebuild which you might have lost. And that's vitally important. So we would sit them down, we would disciple and impart as much as possible on what is happening inside the vision with what we're doing. We would skill and equip them. Every week we would have a different program. And that has been phenomenal to keep them accountable and to keep them full of life and endurance, to keep on running through a tough season. It's just because, you know, it's real. We've seen some pastors have lost a lot of leaders. I've spoken to some pastors that have completely had to start over. We've been beneficial through the fact that we've been able to keep our leadership on fire.
Sure.
But that's what we did.
Sure. Now, before we log off, I know the people are enjoying it.
Praise the Lord.
And we're going to get back here and we're going to discuss leadership. But I know you're a man of vision. I know every year you go before the Lord, number one.
That's perfect.
And you hear what the Lord is saying concerning the year for the area. And then I know very clearly you work strictly according to that vision.
Yes.
So if the Lord said, let's grow the church by 100 people, you're not going to push for 102.
No.
You're going to go for 100 and yes. No more.
Yeah, that's how it works.
Exactly. That's how it works. And I've also seen with that vision, you are very administrative. You know, you have this whole structure you've put together with Pastor Marley, where we have the discipleship structure. You can see who's discipling who. You can see how many people are in the cells. You can see how many people are in the areas. There's feedback systems for everything. How important is that? How important, as we close today, is a vision for an organization, for a ministry? And how important is administration towards that vision?
No, I think the most important thing people need to understand is if we're going to have church underneath a tree, there's no administration. You come and you go, there's no burden that comes with that. But if we want to build a big church, the guy that's running it needs to have some form of control. And he can only influence things if he has control. If he cannot see it, he cannot pay attention to it. And that's why we've built it specifically like that. Is with continuous expansion. So I personally work with a lot of infrastructure. That's the only way if I can see if things are working. And I see, you know, a lot of people had issues because the church went growing. Now, because the church is growing, hallelujah, we have new issues. Yeah. Praise the Lord. So, you know, it's like the issues don't disappear, they just change. But what is vitally important is, I think it was in 2016, I was invited on a pastor's fast. And they explained to me the heart of why we're doing the pastor's fast. And then I was running at that stage for about 4 years, just going into every year of running an area, not as a pastor, but as a leader. And I've learned that if my set man has a relationship with God and he's ministering from his relationship with God, why am I not doing the same thing in my area? I can't just be a robot. I need to be authentically in Christ, living out my own relationship. So I fasted, I prayed, God said to me, in 2016, you're going to go into 2017, you're going to go from 8 to 20 home sales. We did it. The next year, God spoke to me about going from 20 to 40. We did that. The next year after that, very profoundly, God spoke to me and said, we're only going to go from 40 to 50. I'm like, why would we do that? Can't we just push for 80?
Sure.
God said to me, your leadership team can't handle this.
Wow.
And in that year, we saw a massive change over leadership. And we grew consistently. We didn't lose any home sales. We went from 40 to 50 and we sustained that. And that's the thing people, that's the issue people have in ministry. Everybody can pray in tongues.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody can lay hands on the sick, but they cannot build the infrastructure or a discipleship structure where they have competent leaders that are taking ownership of areas.
Mm.
And that's where this is very, very important, because it's about, is this sustainable?
Sure. Pastor Philip, as we draw to a close, there's two things I want you to do. Number one, I want you to look in the camera and just stir up the desire of discipleship in anybody and somebody. You know, there's pastors watching, there's leaders watching, and there's a normal person sitting at home watching. And I want you to stir up the desire. Preach to them. Get that fire for discipleship in them. And then straight after that, do the altar call and close for us in prayer.
Hallelujah. All right, family, I want to encourage you today that I can honestly and sincerely say to you, since I've pursued people, I've been able to see God do a phenomenal work in my life, to see that God is at work in my life and God is at work in other people's lives. And I want to encourage you that if you're in ministry and you are unsatisfied and you feel unsuccessful, if you trust and go into your closet, what I would call your holy place, your upper room, where you would pray and ask God that He would give you a passionate desire to disciple people. I want to pray this morning that you will find that. But as you pursue people, you will see God do a phenomenal work inside of you, as the love of God will minister in and through you to other people.
Yeah.
And I pray that God will give you the necessary endurance and faith to do that. But you will see, if you want God to work in your life, as a pastor, you're going to have to get up out of your couch, stop watching Netflix, get busy, and do the work of the ministry. Because there are many people out there that need your leadership, that need your anointing, and that need your influence.
Mm-hmm.
Hallelujah. And then if there's anybody out there, I would encourage you. In 2007, I made the awesome decision to give my life to Jesus in my room. I didn't have a pastor, or evangelist, or a teacher ministering to me. I was watching the movie called Faith Like Potatoes, and I gave my life to Jesus, and it changed my destiny so much. I completely fell in love with God that day. But I want to encourage you, if you're out there and you've never given your life to Jesus and you've never stepped into a relationship with God, I want to encourage you this morning to join us and pray with us to make that bold decision to receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. And secondly, I want to minister to you if you're a person that has grown cold, you have served God before, but you've become completely mediocre, you're offended, you're just, you're fed up of life. I want to invite you also to step back into that relationship with God. And then thirdly, you might be sitting there and you're not sure if heaven is your home. I want to invite you to step back into making sure that heaven is your destination. So if you are any of those three invitations, I'm going to invite you this morning. We're going to pray together now, and then I'm going to log off and just end off this awesome session. But if you are any of those three invitations, please pray with me. Make sure that you're praying with a heart of faith, and that you're really making a quality decision this morning. All right, so let's pray. Heavenly Father, we say thank you for your grace and mercy. We say thank you that the blood of Jesus cleanses us of all unrighteousness. We receive this gift, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, family, it's as simple as that. That's literally all you need to do. Even if you want to go back and replay this video, you can do that. Just pray that simple prayer. You will step into the kingdom. And I want to encourage you, get into a local church to be activated in the discipleship. Hallelujah.
Amen. Get discipled.
Come on.
Your journey of discipleship starts now. And so this is but the first part. We're gonna sit here for a few weeks. We're going to unpack this. We're going to study this. We're going to look at leadership. We're going to look at the importance of discipleship within that leadership. I know you were blessed today. So do not miss the following session. God bless your family. We love you dearly.
Bye, everybody.
Thank you for watching. Come and join me next week.